Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Vice Chair Boswell, if you would give us the invitation, please.
Be glad to. Bow our heads, please. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for all the blessings you have given to us. Thank you for the blessings you've given to this great country. Dear God, be with us tonight as we go about the county's business. Let us make decisions that are good for the people of the county and wise decisions. These things we ask in thy name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Okay. Sherry's bringing me the book. None. Okay, we do not have any public comments tonight, so I will move on to Industrial Park presentation by Richard Davenport, President of Samet Corporation.
Well, Mr. Davenport's not here tonight.
I didn't think you were.
I'm Ron Rothrock. I'm Executive Vice President of Samet Corporation, and thank you very much for allowing us to come and take a couple minutes tonight to tell you about North Carolina Industrial Center. One thing I'd like to start with is Samet's been around since 1961 and involved in construction and real estate development in North Carolina. In 1987, we had the opportunity to get involved in a project in Alamance County, and because of Avery Thomas invited Norman Samet and I to come over and meet Larry Wagner and look at Riverbend Industrial Park. And at that time, there wasn't any buildings at all in Riverbend. And we built, in 1988, we built the first shell building, spec building, in Riverbend. And shortly thereafter, a company came to look at the shell building, and we saw that they weren't a fit for the shell building, but we talked them into building across the street, and that company was Luxfer. And that was the first big development in Riverbend. And we continued our partnership with the various people in Alamance County, and then late 1999, early 2000, we had the opportunity to begin talking with the Ray family, again with Avery's assistance, and we were able to structure a deal with them to begin the development of North Carolina Industrial Center. And I'm going to let, and Brian Hall's with us tonight. Brian is going to give the presentation on what's transpired since 2000 and since we started developing the park. So thank you very much, and I'm going to turn it over to Brian.
All right, thank you.
Madam Commissioner.
Yes, sir.
Thank you for the opportunity to speak to you tonight. Ron said we've been in business since 1961. 10-15% of our workforce lives here in Alamance County. We were connected with the Ray family, who owned a 603-acre farm in Mebane, courtesy of Avery Thomas and his firm. The Ray family had a vision for creating jobs with their farm, and so we were invited into a partnership with them to enable that to happen. Since 2001, we've spent $1.8 million in infrastructure in the park. Water lines, sewer lines, roads, utilities, getting the properties zoned, doing subdivision, getting the property prepared for jobs. Ford Motor Company in 2003 was the first project in the park, a 250,000 square foot building, over $10 million in real property. Shortly thereafter, Kidde expanded from their campus next door to the park into a 90,000 square foot facility with close to a $4 million investment. Badcock Furniture was next, 200,000 square feet and a $9 million investment. Sports Endeavors followed thereafter, just about $7.5 million. Nipro in 2006, $4.6 million. Continental Components, just over $2 million. Becton Dickinson and Company was March of last year. They've invested close to $6.5 million in their project. And then most recently, the Tri-Vantage. Just 2 weeks ago, we had the groundbreaking out there, which was a great win for Alamance County and a great win for North Carolina Industrial Center. So our totals are over 1 million square feet, and combined with a personal, $73 million in taxable value. Every year, that means $382,000 for the Alamance County General Fund and the fire district there after. And we estimate that there's 780 people currently employed in the park. That's quite a substantial change from a 600-acre farm in 2000 to what lies there today with $73 million of taxable property and 780 jobs. Why have we been successful? We believe it's because of the strategic partnership between the Ray family, Alamance County, and NCIC, the park. Our site conditions, Alamance County provides proximity to the highways. Those highways are important for every single tenant that's in that park. The workforce, the cost of living index, North Carolina Industrial Center, we quote Burlington's cost of living index as 97.3, which is what's been assigned to this Burlington. As comparison, the national average is 100. Raleigh-Durham is 100.3. So that's been beneficial to our success and also the proximity to education. 22 universities and 10 community colleges are within an hour drive of Alamance County. That's critical to our success. NCIC, the infrastructure that we've put in place, the $1.8 million that's been invested in infrastructure, the fast, the covenants that we've put in place that protect the value so that when these folks show up to locate in our park, they understand that 10 years from now, the park's not going to materially change. The buildings that they're going to invest their money in are going to be there. They're going to retain their value. And finally, having sites that are construction ready, that the utilities are there, having a sophisticated seller where we understand what's required to get this facility in place, where they can begin their manufacturing process, where they can begin their distribution process, and begin to turn a profit. Minimizing risk is another reason we've been successful. Alamance County has produced a growth factor. Since from 2000 to 2008, I've got 11.6% growth was shown in Alamance County. That's important to these companies that are locating here. They want to be in a market that is growing. Secondly, the fast-track approval process, being able to understand that they can come into a business-friendly environment, get approved quickly. A great example of that is the Tri-Vantage project, which the groundbreaking was 2 weeks ago. If you were out on site today, you would see the stone being placed for their building pad within 2 weeks. That is difficult to do anywhere else in the state. And finally, the NC site certification process, which Alamance County has participated with us in, that means that the state takes a look at this site and says, of all the sites in the state, we are going to designate North Carolina Industrial Center above the rest with this qualified group of sites to say that we understand that this site has been approved for business. It is a good site, and the state certifies us as such. North Carolina's Industrial Center, we're a sophisticated seller. We understand what it takes to get the companies there. Transactional ease means that the Ray family, in their ownership of this farm, have kept clean title to the property. That's important to these buyers. When they come in, they understand that they can get a clean title that they can rely on, and in turn, maybe one day sell to someone else. And then finally, our due diligence is complete. What that means is our site investigation is done. Here's an example of all the things that have taken place to prepare this park for future users. The zoning is in place. All of our environmental studies are done, wetlands delineations. The utilities are in place, water and sewer. And then finally, our understanding as a construction company of what it takes to get the stormwater plan in place and balancing the site work so that they're not hauling off dirt or hauling in dirt. All of those factors, the studies are complete and they're ready to go. Finally, we've been successful because we provide long-term value protection. Alamance County has shown a great retention of existing industry, and there are examples in this park. Nipro relocated from a building in Riverbend Industrial Park in Graham into a building in NCIC. BD with their recent expansion last year with their facility that's on I-40, and then their growth inside the industrial park. And their basic fundamental advantages of Alamance County in 2009, the industrial real estate report, Alamance County had the lowest industrial vacancy rate of all the triad counties. That was 7.4% at year end of 2009. It's important to these companies. The location, the highways, the workforce, the quality of life that exists here in Alamance County, those are the basic fundamental advantages that the county provides to the industrial park. And then the park, the current tenant list, let me read a couple things for you. Ford Motor Company is number 549 on the Forbes 2000 list. Becton Dickinson is one of Forbes' 400 best big companies. Nipro Carolinas is number 392 on Forbes' largest private companies. Kit of Safety, a subsidy of United Technologies, is number 80 on Forbes' Global 2000. That tenant list is as strong as any industrial park on the East Coast. And we're proud of that, and Alamance County should be proud of that. the protective covenants that are there also ensure the long-term value, because these companies, they know who their neighbors are going to be. Someone's not going to be able to come in next door to them and put in something that would devalue their property. The covenants protect them from that. And in short, it provides an exit strategy for these companies. That, you know, everybody always looks at the worst-case scenario. So if this company were to come and locate in the park, if they had to sell or release, they felt confident that they would be able to get a market rate when they resold it. They're confident that they could put a new tenant back in the building. That's important. So these are the reasons we've been successful. Who's our competition? We have competition, and it's fierce. In the Triad, we compete dollar for dollar with other Triad locations. The real estate value is the same. The cost to build is the same. The cost of infrastructure is the same. Other North Carolina counties. Again, I'd like to read for you a list. And this list was published in the Business Journal this year. And this list is the largest industrial parks in the Triad. Number 8 on that list was Piedmont Triad West Corporate Park, that is owned and developed by Surrey County Economic Development. Number 9 is Reedsville Industrial Park, Rockingham County Economic Development. Number 11 is Central Piedmont Industrial Park, Randolph County Economic Development. There's 5 more that are on the top 25 list. North Carolina Industrial Center is number 4, and it's been a private development, which is important to designate. We are competing with county-owned industrial parks in other counties in the state. Projects that are in the park competed with these different locations across the state and even out of our state into Virginia. Orange County, Danville, Virginia, Liberty, again, another Nipro in Danville. How can we set ourselves apart? We are the premier industrial park to begin attracting companies away from Research Triangle Park. That's where we have a competitive advantage for real estate pricing, the cost to do business in the Triangle versus the cost to do business here. Incentives are important in every aspect of the game. They keep us competitive. The value that NCIC creates is that there's no other county real estate investment that is necessary. The county doesn't have to go out and develop its own industrial park. Performance-based incentives are cheap. To be able to have the clawbacks that are provided in these incentive agreements to enable the county to protect itself long-term are important. And the partnership that is provided between the Alamance County, the Ray family is the owner, and Max Group in the economic development provides the horsepower to land these projects successfully, which we've done. In conclusion, in the future, we've got 16 outstanding proposals that are there, projects of all shapes and sizes, 2 to 80 acres. We've submitted the park to become an NC-certified site, which I talked about that designation earlier. We've submitted the site to be designated as the best rail site by the North Carolina Railroad. And we're actively pursuing data center marketing, which is an expanding growth market we see, an opportunity for the park. Future challenges. 1 or 2 big deals in the park, and phase 1 will be complete for us. What that means is that we've got to figure out how we extend infrastructure into phase 2 and 3, which becomes complicated. There are topography and wetland issues that will have to be overcome. Phase 1 was the easy part of the park to develop, so there are future challenges with the development of our park. Together, this partnership with Alamance County, the Ray family, Samet, Mac Williams Group, it's proven to work. We provide available, capable sites, low project risk, and the best long-term value. I'd like to invite Avery Thomas up to speak on behalf of the Ray family, the owners of the park. Thank you very much.
On behalf of the Ray family, I'd like to thank the commissioners for the support of helping to create jobs, which was the desire of C.M. Mac Ray. He had wanted his land to be used for the creation of jobs. You might remember when we were recruiting Mercedes, they were going to bring us 1,500 jobs right off. Well, we're at 750, and it's taken us 9 years, but we've done that. But I'd like to relate a story during the Mercedes so-called buffalo hunt. We were having a meeting in Mebane, and before the meeting, this lady was sitting there and says, I really like Mebane just like it is. It's just great. I don't want to make any changes. I certainly don't want to use any tax money to change it at all. And so I decided to pursue that, and I said, well, are you a native? And she said, no. I said, what brought you to Mebane? Turns out that her husband got a job with one of the first industries that the county recruited. Tom Policastro was recruiting for the county, and it was either GKN or KIT, I can't remember. And then I said, do you have family? And she said, well, I don't have any here. And she thought about it, and it was silent, just silent. And then she said, I really wish my son-in-law could find a job here so I could be closer to my grandchildren. And do you know, to this day, that lady doesn't know what she said, but I tore up the speech I'd written. She made my case. And I think people don't realize that is what we're trying to do, is create jobs for our children. I used to, when I was president of the chamber, I read the paper every Sunday when they had the wedding announcements. And if you read that and you read how many of our kids went to high school here, their parents live here, and they're moving away. They're going to other places, and that's what we really need to try to avoid. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Thomas. Okay. Thank you so much for that pertinent information that we need. And don't go anywhere. We'd love to keep you here now, Mr. Thomas.
Well, I would say, are there any questions or
yes,
anything?
Yes, are there any questions about
Has this land all been zoned already for business, the whole 600-acre tract?
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Okay, the next thing. Thanks, Matt. Is Civil War Trails update by Eric Richardson? Okay. Hello, Commissioners. I'm very well. Before I begin, I'd like to inform Commissioner Lashley and Commissioner Sutton, because for years I came and talked to y'all about Mountain Trail. That Mountain Trail is now a state-maintained road.
Thank you.
Thank y'all.
We're glad.
It only took 10 years. Mr. Martin says that's pretty good for the state of North Carolina, because normally it takes 10-20. So I got in half the time.
How far up did it go?
They're past my driveway. And once
it
gets past
that's
my driveway,
right?
Enough.
It's enough.
I covered enough.
That's far enough.
I have been on that road.
It's still not enough.
Before it was fixed.
I'm sorry.
I know, it's horrible.
We would not invite friends to our home because we didn't have to apologize for that
Jason
road.
Jason and I have talked about that, Mountain. We have another one just as bad.
Well, I tried to convince the DOT to go across the other side of the hill to Fire Tower, and they just didn't.
I know where that
is. They didn't quite want to go across that side of the hill. Tonight, I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the Civil War Trails program. Before I begin, I'd like to thank Commissioner Sutton specifically for this. And Commissioner Sutton knows why I'm thanking him. Let me inform the rest of the commission why. Commissioner Sutton, was that 4 years ago or 5 years ago you gave me that
thesis? Yeah. Well, I stumbled across it kind of by accident by calling the Greensboro Historical Museum.
Mm-hmm.
And I was inquiring about why there was no pictures of Jefferson Davis going up Elm Street.
Mm-hmm.
To have the meeting with Johnston, and you know, that was where they made the big plans, you know.
Yes, sir.
So, long story short, he told me about this thesis that this UNCG professor had written years ago that was that thick.
Mm-hmm.
And you had to pay per page, and I paid like $14 at UNCG to get it, and then gave it to you.
And I paid $20 at Kinko's to copy it. So I'd have been better off going to Greensboro. Well, I'd have been better off going to Greensboro and sharing my money with the university system, but I didn't do it that way. With the thesis that Commissioner Sutton shared with me, I went to some friends of mine in Virginia who run the Civil War Trails program and said to them, the state of North Carolina and Civil War Trails have invested a tremendous amount of money to bring Sherman's army into North Carolina. And if you look at and Robert Cox ran out of the maps, but if you see on the front of your handout, this is the map, the Civil War Trails map, that the state of North Carolina gives out at the rest areas when you come into the state of North Carolina. Because of our program in Alamance County, the state of North Carolina has to redraw their map. We get a new map because of us. And so if you look inside, part of our program
follows the route of General Johnston's army in April of 1865. And this comes directly from what Commissioner Sutton shared with me. If you look at the end, at the table of contents, those would be stop number one, Johnston's withdrawal at Belmont. Stop number three, Johnston's withdrawal, logisticians at work is in Burlington. Johnston's withdrawal at Ruffin's Mill. We know Ruffin's Mill today as Swepsonville. Johnston's withdrawal at Hardee's Column is also in the southern part of the county, the Regulator Field or the Alamance Battleground, and Johnston's withdrawal at the Village of Alamance. All of those are connected to the Carolina campaign in April of 1865. That will be a red line across the state of North Carolina, running from Bentonville to Greensboro back to Bennett Place, across Alamance twice. So we've got the first stage of it coming into Alamance County. The other stops that will go in at the beginning will be in Burlington for the North Carolina Railroad, in northeastern part of the county at Pleasant Grove, on Daly Store Road with the Okanichee Tribal Land, and down in Snow Camp, there will be three stops in the initial first phase, one dedicated to Freedom's Hill Wesleyan Church, one to McKay McPherson, and a third to Cane Creek Meeting House. And so we will have, according to the executive director of the Civil War Trails program, the most diverse of all Civil War Trail programs across five states. So Alamance has a good reason to pat themselves on the back. Along those lines, I'd like to call and give specific thanks to Jason Martin from Planning, Brian Haygood with Parks and Recreation, and Robert Cox with Convention and Visitors Bureau, because I wouldn't have been able to put this together without those three men's help. And we look to expand this onto the county's website.
Hopefully, so that's something that we're looking at, setting this up to where it's interactive through GIS as well. So.
And what you'll be able to do is, if you have an iPhone and you're driving through the county, you get to, let's say, the Okanichee Tribal Land up on Daly Store Road. You open your iPhone up, you tap on the map of the county, and you'll get a PDF, which will give you additional information on the stop that you're at, and will also give you directions on how to get to the next place, and if you want, to stop to get something to eat, or to shop, or what have you. When we drove this into February, it took us about 3 hours to do all these stops driving across the county. So if we can get somebody here, we can keep them here for almost half a day. So we're hoping they'll stay the night. But this is the initial first phase that's going in. Do any of y'all have any questions on this? There is a tremendous amount of work in this. Tremendous amount of work. We expect this to go in the end of June or 1st of July. We're waiting on the Department of Commerce. Thank y'all.
Is that routed on this map?
No, ma'am. I'm sorry, it is not. That's we were hoping to get the website up. I had asked Mr. Martin's planner to do it, and we couldn't get it up in time.
But it will be forthcoming.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Richardson, for that. Next is Gary Anders, who is going to talk to us about Children's Mental Health Awareness Day Proclamation. Are you Mr. Anders?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Commissioners, appreciate having the opportunity to present this proclamation to you on Children's Mental Health Awareness Day. This year has a special focus on young children. May actually is Mental Health Awareness Month, and May 6th is Children's Mental Health Awareness Day, which we are planning an event at the Graham Library, and one of our local children's authors, Jane Belk Moncure, is going to be reading one of her books, What Do You Do with a Grumpy Kangaroo? To children and their parents, and she's going to be signing those books and giving them away. But it's a book specifically on young children's social emotional development, and so we think that that's kind of cool. I'd like to read this.
Pardon?
May 6th. Which is this Thursday, right? So I'd like to read this proclamation, and then if I could just have a couple of minutes and give you a real short update on where we are with the Alamance Alliance for Children and Families. And to thank you for your ongoing support of the work that we're doing and with this SAMHSA grant. Whereas strong mental health is essential for young children to be healthy and ready for school, and whereas in fiscal year 2008-2009, Alamance County Department of Social Services investigated 1,466 reports of child abuse and neglect involving 603 children under the age of six. And of these reports, 192 were in need of services or substantiated for abuse or neglect. And whereas 44% or 53 children presently in foster care are between the ages of 0 and 5. And whereas a substantial portion of abused and neglected children suffer with social and emotional distress, including post-traumatic stress disorder. And whereas 10 to 15% of developing preschoolers estimated in Alamance County at 1,447 children have chronic, mild to moderate levels of behavioral problems. And whereas untreated behavioral problems may lead to many children being removed from their homes and placed into foster care, and at times expelled from their child care settings. And whereas it is important that children, along with their families and communities, learn about the warning signs of mental health disorders and where to obtain necessary assistance and treatment. And whereas early diagnosis and appropriate treatment for mental health disorders among children provide them better opportunities to lead full and productive lives. And whereas the participation of family members in the assessment of treating and treatment of children is integral to positive clinical outcomes. And whereas an awareness of the mental health services provided in Alamance County can lead to diagnosis and treatment of these mental health disorders. And whereas parents, teachers, guidance counselors, social workers, medical professionals, neighbors, friends, and concerned citizens recognize that there are many ways to reach out to the children of Alamance County that are in need of education, protection, and mental health resources. And whereas National Mental Health Awareness Day provides an important opportunity for our community to show how children and youth with mental health needs, as well as their families, thrive when they have the right supports and services available. And now, therefore, we would hope, the Alamance Board of County Commissioners does hereby proclaim May 6, 2010, Children's Mental Health Awareness Day in Alamance County.
I do have a signed proclamation.
Thank you very much.
Amen. It is signed by all of us. And thank you so much for that presentation.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
Mm-hmm. Does anybody have any questions for Mr. Andrew?
Can I give you a brief update?
Sure.
2 minutes?
Sure.
So over the last year and a half, you know, we had a planning year, and we've done tremendous planning and finished the strategic plan and logic model. We've created portals of entry for our children. Again, you know, the purpose of our program is to build a sustainable network of services and supports, mental health services and supports for very young children and their families that will work to deal with their mental health needs, specifically social emotional needs. Therefore, those portals are the Children's Development Service Agency and the Alamance Burlington School System. These are all sustainable places that we've developed MOAs with. We've trained 35 people from seven different teams in wraparound child and family teams. We're in the process of training 47 clinicians, 22 of those from Alamance County on trauma-focused cognitive behavioral therapy. We're training a five-person Alamance team in parent-child interaction therapy. We have 30 children to date who have had in-home social and emotional assessments done by a child psychologist. We have 20 children now enrolled in the Alliance with services being provided. 75% of these children have been affected by trauma. We have assigned family partners to 12 families. Family partners are other family members who have actually gone through similar processes with their children and have had similar experience. We have added 60 families to the Incredible Years Parenting Program for children with behavioral problems. So we've done a lot of work. We started opening the door just a very little bit to accept referrals into the program because we didn't have much treatment capacity. There's no treatment capacity any place in the state. With these almost 50 clinicians in the region that we're training, this summer we'll be opening the doors wide open, and I think that we'll see lots of children being affected. What I would hope is that 6 months from now, I can give you a lot of data. You know, we're working with a major firm to do evaluation and to collect data for us, and I hope that I can give you yearly updates in which the data that we have should have pretty dramatic results for the children and families of Alamance County. So again, I appreciate the support that you all have given this project.
I ask a question. I didn't know you were going to refer to SAMHSA, I suppose, until I got my agenda packet, and I had some SAMHSA-related questions, if I'm pronouncing that correctly. Is that correct?
SAMHSA. It's Substance Abuse and Mental Health Service Administration.
Yeah, and I had some questions that, from the last meeting that I just let go, frankly. And I feel like, you know, I got to ask them now. I mean, I was going to let them go. I didn't feel like belaboring that night, that evening any further. But out of 100 counties, and we're performing what services we're performing here as a result of SAMHSA, whatever. Out of 100 counties, how many other counties are doing the same or not doing the same as a result of not having the grant?
There are no other counties working with an early childhood population. Mecklenburg has a SAMHSA grant right now, and they're working with a school-age population.
So if you don't have the grant, it's just not being done. Is that what you're saying?
It's not being done to the extent that I think that we can do it. And, you know, part of our goal here is, one of the things I mentioned was that we have 47 clinicians who are, involved in this trauma-focused cognitive behavioral therapy, learning collaborative. So 25 of those are outside of Alamance County. We have some folks involved in that from Wilmington, some folks involved in that from the western part of the state, Mecklenburg, Pitt County. So one of our goals, and one of my goals with this, is actually to be able to tell SAMHSA that we're working across the state from the mountains to the sea to start building real service capacity to start serving these children. So we'll set a model in Alamance County, which is one of the great things, I think, that we've been pretty avant-garde in Alamance to set models that the state can then follow. And that's clearly one of our goals in working with the State Collaborative for Children, Youth, and Families.
Duke University has been paid how much over the last 2 years to do these surveys?
Quite a bit.
And my record shows about $700,000. Is that correct?
I would think that that's high because we have two contracts with Duke. We have one contract with Duke to provide some of this training that we're doing right now, and that's with the Center for Child and Family Health, along with the Duke Center for Child Traumatic Stress. We do have another contract with Duke with the Center for Child and Family Policy, and they're an evaluation arm. Most of the SAMHSA grants actually have relationships with universities to do evaluation.
Well, they thrive off of grants. I mean, you know, without getting into that debate, can you give me an example of what Duke will do up here for that $500,000 for 1 year? I'm sure we've paid them, I think, roughly $500,000 for 1 year for two different surveys combined.
But it's not just surveys.
Whatever they're doing, give me an example of what they're doing.
Yeah,
clarify.
Sure.
The evaluation is mandated, so we don't have a choice of doing the mandated evaluation. They're doing both local and national evaluation. The national evaluation contains 15 different instruments that has to be given to families every 6 months during the course of the grant. Those instruments alone take about 3 hours to complete with family members. They're also involved in local evaluation, in which they're looking at the fidelity of how these clinicians do their work. They're looking at the collaborative process in Alamance County relative to SAMHSA. There's mandated, mandated evaluation.
Last question. Do you think they're cost effective?
I hope so. I think that, I'm kind of not a big data person generally. I like to see the work done. I like working with families. I like seeing things happen. The thing that I've learned, though, about data in the last 5 to 10 years is that you have to have data to do the next step. I mean, if you don't support what you're doing, if you don't prove that what you're doing actually works and has an effect, then we're not going to be able to keep it moving. That support, like we have to get support from insurance companies and from Medicaid in order to make sure that they'll pay for these services long term. And without that, that won't happen. And they need data in order to support the fact that what we're doing is going to have long-term positive effects for children and their families.
Gary, can I make a statement?
Certainly.
I find it a shame that we couldn't have done this maybe 20 years earlier, that we do have young children, and you have to be in the schools to know that, they do have severe behavioral problems. And they're young adults now, and we have all these crimes being committed, and you're going, well, what happened? Why are these young people shooting up, and why do they do this? And if we could have done this so much earlier, maybe some of these kids could have been saved. I am very thankful that we are doing it now, and I do thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. I had that same epiphany a few years ago. Both the health department director and the director of the Partnership for Children were telling these stories about early brain development and the effects of social, emotional, environmental concerns on early brain development. Well, 85% of early brain development takes place between the ages of 0 and 3. And again, that's affected by social, emotional concerns. What does that mean? If it's their environment, if they're exposed to domestic violence, which is a huge piece, substance abuse, mental illness, other kinds of trauma, being removed from their homes. These are huge pieces that some of this data is, 75% of the kids that we're identifying are affected by trauma. I mean, have these huge trauma incidents in their lives. And so I think that that's going to be important information, and as we have more of that, I want to share that with you, because I think that it'll be important to feel good about what we're doing, and I'd like you, Commissioner, to feel good about what we're doing.
Well, you gag me on a little bit. What I'm saying, and I'll keep saying it, grants are tax dollars, whether they're out of my back pocket, county's back pocket, state's back pocket, they're tax dollars. And we've all admitted pretty much that we're addressing a lot of these needs without these grants. Maybe we're just not getting as much data as a result of not having the grant. We've got a grant now, so we go pay Duke University $500,000 to come up here and ask some questions. I oppose that stuff. I'm sorry. It's bureaucracy and it's tax dollars, in my opinion, at times wasted. Now, I'm not saying that the whole SAMHSA grant's a waste, but for the $6 million that you're going to spend, you're going to have to look for ways to spend the money. And I expect Duke is hiring Duke to do these type of studies. Is no offense. you know, that's a good place to send the money down to. But for the numbers of children that you might serve, that you would have served anyway, versus the 6 million, I do question the flow of the dollars here. I'm sorry. And,
I
love kids as much as anybody, because I have a grandchild and two sons and a stepdaughter, and I can assure you that I know the troubles they have in their lives, and the troubles that our children do have. But you know, my question about how many counties don't have this grant, you know, I just don't believe those children are going unattended, is what I'm trying to get out there. And you got the grant, so go spend it.
Gary, how many foster children? I'm sorry, you done this?
No, yeah, unless I think something else.
How many foster children do we have right now? Do you know?
114, about.
But and until people know where these fosters, I worked in foster care in Orange County. I dealt with the foster parents. And I've seen firsthand these neglected kids that come in there. They've been thrown against a wall by their parent. These are things that this grant will help with, is to try to stop that kind of behavior on the parents, because the parents have to go to classes too to make sure. I know they did at one point. So
well, certainly all these activities and interventions that we're putting in place, when you speak of young children, you know, most of the work is with their parents.
That's right. I've seen a mother give 3 kids away, sign them over for adoption, just boom. I notarized the papers for them, by the way. But I mean, this is something that I am thrilled that we have this, and I think that we're doing a great job. And it's like, but we do see these in without them being in school. You know, I've seen lots of these kids come in screaming and hollering and fighting and kicking. And
we clearly, Commissioner, want to put an end to that cycle, because
exactly.
We know that these children who are being identified come from families in which the same thing happened to those parents.
Exactly.
And we have to stop that cycle at some place. And we've been trying to stop it when there are teenagers, like with the JCPC that Commissioner Sutton sits on. But you know, my epiphany was, being the chair of JCPC, that it was too late. That for those children who are already involved in the juvenile justice system, we weren't going to make huge changes in their lives anymore. We'd make some minimal changes in their lives, but you know, there are some pretty ingrained patterns already there. I mean, if given again, 85% of brain development happens between the ages of 0 and 3, that what we needed to really do is put our money and a lot of our work into early childhood, and to get children ready for school, socially and emotionally ready for school.
And I thank you for that.
And see, up to now, we haven't been able to identify those children unless someone reports them to law enforcement or DSS or whatever. And what you're doing is getting these children early. And that's where it needs to be.
That's exactly right. And the reason, I mean, one of the reasons people never identified these children is there were no services. And so why do you identify the children? I mean, I've talked to a physician's assistant who said, I've seen these children, but I wouldn't identify because I didn't want to put it in the chart because then I'd be liable. There's nothing to do with them. I didn't have no services. We're putting those services into place. And so I think that this could have dramatic impact. I'm excited.
And thank you for doing that.
Thanks for your concerns. And thanks for your support.
Okay, the next thing is Jordan Lake Rules Update with Mr. Jason Martin.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, good evening. I'll be very, very brief tonight. As you may recall, back in December, I brought before the board the Stage 1 Adaptive Management Plan, which was required under the Jordan Lake rules, which basically laid out how we would address public outreach and education, illicit discharge elimination, BMP maintenance, and those issues. There were 5 specifically in that. As of right now, we've submitted that to the state, to the Division of Water Quality, and with that they had 6 months to review that and send us back comments and make a recommendation to the Environmental Management Commission. If they have not already done so, I was told that they were recommending denial of our Stage 1 Adaptive Management Plan to the Environmental Management Commission. Now, I have not heard whether or not they actually denied it yet, but as soon as we get that, we will get written comments that we will need to address, and so this will be going back to the Planning Board, most likely back before you all. I plan to take this If I can get it in front of the planning board next week, then that's what we will do. But if not, we will do it in June. But we will have some time until the middle of July to respond to it. So at this point, I have not had any other comments from the state regarding the buffer ordinance that we sent to them. Nothing has come back on that. But just like the Stage 1 Adaptive Management Plan, they have 6 months to respond to that. And then we'll have, hopefully they'll approve it and we won't have to do any more work with it. But one other quick update on the Jordan Lake rules. I do know that we should be getting a draft of the current development rules at some point here in the very near future. We have until next summer to implement that. From what I understand, the state has employed somebody to draft that model ordinance now, and hopefully it will be very succinct and something that's easy for everybody to read and comprehend. So, with that, I'll be glad to take any questions. I just felt we should give you an update tonight on this.
You don't know what points they denied?
Not officially. I've had a little bit of unofficial comment back and forth with some of the folks there. What I've been told, it was more about details than the actual substance. It was more about when will we implement something, with the public education program. And for example, we're members with the Piedmont Triad Water Quality Partnership, and they do the television commercials with Lenny the Lifeguard and, all that pet waste pickup and all that stuff. These things are what we need to put in there and show where we're doing it now and, look, kind of match it up with their plans as well for school education, what year will that take place, and kind of give the details. There was some confusion on illicit discharges. They were curious as to whether or not we had a local ordinance. And I spoke with Carl Carroll at Environmental Health and was informed they take their authority for that from general statutes and North Carolina Administrative Code. So we'll specify that. But those were the kind of the details, more or less. Not so much actual substance, but when will something be implemented and those time frames. And like I said to you all when I presented it the first time, I wanted to give them what we do currently and see how well that matches up with what their goal is, and then let them submit something back and say, well, we need clarification on this. And so start with what we currently do, the least impact on taxpayers, least impact on staff, least impact on developers and citizens. So,
what's Durham doing now?
I honestly haven't heard anything from Durham. I'm not real familiar with what their proposal was. I have heard that there's only a handful of local governments that they were recommending approval on their Stage 1 Adaptive Management Plan. And I think one of them was the town of Summerfield. But that was it. But I honestly haven't seen anybody else's Adaptive Management Plan except Graham. I have seen that one.
Thank you, Jason. Next is Mr. Albright with the Amber Walker update on Guilford County Line.
The first step in our public informational process has been taken to meet with the folks impacted by the Guilford Alamance Line. We're going to have a public information meeting next Monday night at the Gibsonville Town Hall beginning at 5:30. Go on till 7 or until questions are answered. We prepared a letter, joint letter. I've been working closely with the Guilford County Attorney on the notices and what we're going to have in these discussions in our meetings. Bruce has prepared a map, I think he's passed out to you. What we anticipate doing at the meeting is having larger copies of maps A through J and inviting people to come up and look and see just how their property is impacted. And then asking them what their concerns are, focusing on fire, safety, schools, issues that we've addressed with Orange County. And we'll report back to you after our informational meeting.
Again, those maps show the Alamance County parcels that would be impacted and the addresses that are highlighted, the actual homes that would be impacted. So that's a real, you had asked for that last time, a real close-up view so you could really see in certain areas. And we will be, again, we'll be showing large maps. Also, hopefully as maybe tonight or first thing in the morning, Guilford County and Alamance County are working on a website where they can click on their address and go directly to a map and see where they're impacted. That should be up possibly this evening, if not tomorrow. And so that's available as well. We've rushed to get this public hearing in order. And again, everybody got their letters last Thursday, I believe. And people have already started calling today.
I got three calls today.
So, again, in relation to Orange County, you know, Orange County had 100, 150 homes impacted. This is only about 50 homes at this point. The lines are much closer in the Guilford-Alamance line, so it's hopefully less controversy on that. I didn't even get to talk to Craig today, but Orange County contacted us, and we're real close to doing a joint presentation of what we talked about as a possible compromise from last fall for commissioners' comments and approval, and maybe as early as the 17th and 18th. Again, I got an email late today about that. Again, we're trying to make sure we present at the same time so that there's no miscommunications between two counties. And again, it's something we had a meeting, I think it was April 19th, where we came to a real good consensus, and I think we broke the logjam on that. So we're hopefully making some progress here, and we'll inform you as soon as we find out more information.
We need to start thinking about our local legislation for the proposed bill, Alamance, Guilford, and Orange, so we can give you the tools that you need to make these transitions.
Yeah, because I was going to ask that question. We have the same, can we do the same thing in Guilford, like to move the property line?
I would hope
that if
they're
on the line, then we can do the same thing.
If both sets of commissioners choose to follow that path, again, once you see the proposal, you certainly could apply on the Guilford County side.
Okay. I would hope that the Guilford commissioners would be willing to do that for their citizens as well. But we've got a real good working relationship with the Orange County attorney and the Guilford County attorney. And if we can go to Raleigh together with a similar bill, we can get this thing done maybe by the end of the year, maybe.
Is this supposed to say Guilford County instead of Orange County?
Did I write that on there? I did this afternoon. I'm sorry about that. You're right. I did do that. See, I got Orange County line on the brain. Thank you.
We better settle this quick. Orange.
I just printed it out this afternoon.
And we just scratch Orange.
Just scratch Orange County after
that. That was a real old man.
And it's amazing when Sutton catches it.
Thank you.
That was a real old man.
Jesus Christ. What about Skip Austin's letter that went out, that he emailed? We got email copies of all that. Have you seen all this?
With their resolution?
Yeah.
Is that what you're thinking about?
Yeah.
They have adopted the survey, the geodetic survey.
Right.
And they have instructed their staff to work with us and come up with a transition plan. So I think that meeting... He wants a straight line. He made
right, exactly.
Yeah.
And he's the letter. Did he write the letter to the legislators of Guilford County contingent without the consensus of his board?
He wasn't.
That I'm not sure.
Possibly. I have no idea.
That I'm not sure.
I'd be afraid to say it one way or the other.
Well, I know it's pattern, but the letter was fairly dogmatic. This is what we're doing. I mean, you know, any question? Are they going to be at the meeting?
Yes.
They've been invited. Their manager signed the letter.
Yes. Yes. So.
Did you see the letter?
I did.
I got emailed.
I got it. Yeah. Was my. I thought they had already made a move on it.
I thought they had too.
We just both just follow right on in there.
They've jumped the gun a whole lot more than we have.
We've tried to be deliberate and we've tried to be sensitive to people in this issue.
9-1 vote
from their.
To go with the geodetic. Is that what you're saying? Or you've heard?
That's what that resolution was. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Have you heard
it? That was my understanding that they voted 9-1 to recognize the geodetic survey.
That's right. What I think.
They've adopted the line, and now the other part of that resolution was to come up with a method to transition people.
And but we don't know if their transition is to have any jig jags in the line or not.
Yes, my understanding that what they're saying is, this is the line, and now we're going to help you get through it, and you know, help you break you in. That's the way I didn't see any wiggle room there myself.
Well, that's why Gibson people was so mad.
Yeah.
Well,
exactly.
The county line requires the consent of this board, too.
Right.
Well, how many miles is that between Orange County now and Guilford County when these two counties get through?
Depends on who you ask. If you ask Mr. Shue, I think it's, what, 26?
I want to tell you, Mr. Shue has had another heart attack that morning.
I'm sorry to hear that.
I talked with his wife today, and she said, Linda, that's why Eddie has not been there, and I didn't want to. Anyway,
he got on the radio and blasted me today, so he must be in fairly good shape.
She said he had to calm down. So she did.
Quit getting on the radio.
She did tell me that he had another
heart in the
bad position. That's just FYI.
It's a trick.
So, okay, any more questions of these gentlemen?
So it's next Monday at, is it 5 or 5:30?
I think 5:30, but Bruce and I are going to be over there a little early just in case some early birds show up. From the calls I got today, I'm. I have a feeling they're going to be waiting on us.
Yeah, I don't know that they can get them all in their little council.
We suggested a larger room, but at the Guilford County request, we are meeting at the Gibson Mill Town Hall.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Yep.
Okay, now we have budget amendments 136 and 139 from Richard.
That's what they think.
Yeah, and at the top.
At the top, too.
Yeah.
I just got
to
phone somebody
or
head on
the brain. Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening.
DSS is requesting two budget revisions tonight. The first is to request a update of all the latest state and federal revenue changes. You see there are quite a few of those. And the bottom line on these are that there is a net increase in revenues, non-county revenues of $282,102. There is a net increase in revenues of $292,157. What that means is there's a net $10,000 increase of revenues over expenditures. Because of the way the dollars came in and the line items they support, we're able to free those up, and that actually relieves some expense that is typically a county burden as part of this amendment. The biggest impacts here are about $300,000 increase in our crisis intervention program. That's a pass-through program. A $56,000 reduction in our domestic violence program, which is also pass-through to a contractor. And then a reduction in state aid to county funds of $64,000, which is cut that the governor implemented in order to help with the state budget situation.
Any questions on that from anybody?
Yeah, I'd like to ask Amy or Craig to comment on this, if they would, as far as recommending approval.
It is really just a pass through and no really county dollars involved.
That's what I was asking for.
And a net savings of county dollars.
Right, yes. I just want to hear from county management.
Yes, sir. All right. The second budget amendment is to kick off to implement a new federal funding program, a new line. It is the FNS, or Food Stamps Administrative Contingency Grant. What these are additional dollars that were passed by the federal government as part of the defense spending bill in order to support the growth in food stamp applications that we're seeing in North Carolina across the country. So what this is an increase in our food stamps administration program of $151,000. What this does is allow us additional funds to hire some temp staff. We're not adding any additional permanent staff. We are adding some temporary staff. We're paying overtime, and we are purchasing some computers to help support that process and that operation. Vast majority of that $125,000 is in temp salaries. They will take applications as these additional clients come in. As the funds go away, obviously those temp positions go away as well. And again, no county dollars involved in this.
Tax dollars.
Yes, sir.
Federal tax dollars.
Yes, sir.
Forgive me. It is local dollars. Didn't they up the limit of what you could make and get food stamps?
Yes, sir.
All right, can you give us a breakdown on that, just overall?
I don't know the specifics of how that program operates. From a financial perspective, what they've done is they have raised the income limit. A family of four that makes $44,000 will now be eligible for food stamps. So what that will do in our projections is increase the potential for a one-third increase in our food stamp applications coming through the program.
Okay. Do you know how much dollar evaluation they would get, family of four?
No, sir.
Okay. If we voted no on this, is this just a formality, or if we voted no, what would happen? Would the money actually go back, or what?
It is actually money that's already been allocated to us by the state. We've received the allocation letter. It is in our budget pots. And there are no, as we would see the clients, we would bill the services. We would claim the services and get paid for those. So if you vote no, it would not, the budget would not be on the books. But we would still have to report the services as we see the clients and draw down those associated dollars.
So it's just a formality.
Any more questions?
Can we vote separately? Separate items.
I guess we can. We'll vote on the, hear a motion accept number 136?
I'll make a motion that we accept 136.
Okay. Have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Next, I need a motion to accept number 139 budget amendment.
That's the food stamps, right?
Right. I'll make a motion to accept that.
Have a motion on the floor to accept that. Have a second. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed?
No.
Passes.
Thank you.
Do we advertise for food stamp usage?
I'm not aware that we do.
Well, you know, when I was on the Social Services Board, there was a push to get the participation level higher.
Yes, sir. We did at one time. We were being asked to get our participation level higher because we were among the lowest in the state, and you're correct, you were on the board at that time. I think we started out at about 29% participation rate, and the state goal was 67. Since then, we're in line with all the other counties. Everyone's roles have gone up, and no, we do not actually get out and advertise. There are posters that are put out by the USDA, and they're sent to our office, and we have those posted and that type of thing. And certainly, you know, if someone calls for information, we'll send that out. But as far as going out and, putting out brochures and that kind of thing, you know, we're not doing that. There's a lot of public awareness campaigns out there, and you're aware, with, again, posters and advertisements, even on some cable channels, you know, that kind of thing. So it is being done. But we obviously do not have the personnel to go out doing that. We, in the past, were putting them in places like libraries and senior housing, trying to, as you would recall, increase the participation among the elderly. That was our primary focus at that time, and so we were going into some of the senior housing and those type places. You are correct about that, but yeah. It's been a couple years.
I think federal government has advertised. I've heard radio advertisement about it.
Exactly. That's true. I've even seen a few commercials run.
Well, a lot of people I've heard since the limits were raised have complained. In fact, the limit's too high for somebody to get food stamps if they're making $44,000 a year.
And that may, in fact, go into effect in June or July. Right. We've not gotten, it'll increase it to 200% of federal poverty. So we've heard some from both.
Well, sure.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Okay, next is our county manager reports and budget discussion.
Thank you again, Madam Chairman, and I guess I'm back.
Where are we at? These are changes that we have had from our last meeting. Use of ADM funds for school debt service was not supported by the school system for the 2009-10 or 2010-11 budget year. What does that mean to us? Currently, we have $1.6 million budgeted in this year's budget to use the ADM funds to balance our budget. We can't use that funds. So therefore, that's another $1.6 million we're in the hole this year. We were planning to use an additional $1.7 million of the ADM fund in next year's budget. They've kind of said no to that as well because it requires a joint resolution of both boards. We have talked.
May I ask a question about that? Was that resolution unanimous?
I'm not sure.
I don't think it was. I think 5-6, 5-2 vote. I don't think it was unanimous.
Right.
Well, I know they had a split vote on
sending the budget.
Yeah, the budget, yeah, sending the budget.
Right. Itself.
And I'm curious about the vote for not using ADM.
I'm not sure of.
I don't remember that.
What the budget was. If to use the ADM funds, it requires a local match of the county of 25%. In the past, according to Amy and talking with Dr. Bridges, the board has always supported the school system's use of that, and that 25% has come from fund balance. The schools have stated that they plan to use the ADM money in next year's budget to cover some technology purchases. Technology does not require a match from the county, therefore it does not require our approval, so they can use those funds.
Without us approving it?
Without us approving it, because it is for technical purchases. They did allow us, they did agree to work with us on the outstanding interest that is on two series of bonds. They have a lot, if you remember, it's the 06 bonds and what was he? Is it just 06?
It's just phase one and phase two of 06.
That's right. I knew those two phases of the construction bonds in 06. There's still pots of money out there that they have not used and they have not finished their construction of that. Or they may have finished the projects, but they have not closed it out. There's interest that is associated with those bonds of $1.7 million. They did said instead of using ADM funds, we will agree to allow you to use the interest. So that's at least something that we can get going forward. We did look at talking about lowering our self-insured insurance fund. As we've talked about before, we've gone from 500 to 400 in this year. We made that retroactive. We were looking at going to 400 next year. Again, our claims are in line. We were looking at increasing that fund balance. The thought process was at least for this coming year to lower it another $50, which would save us $550,000. So we would still be in good shape on our fund balance. We'd still have, I think, close to $8 million in that fund. Is that a?
Probably about seven.
Seven, yeah. Okay. So in the fund balance, so again, for the short term, in the situation we are trying to look at all areas of revenue, we feel comfortable in doing that. Any questions on this slide? Okay. One of the things that came up from Commissioner Vaughn was to look at the possibility of an early retirement incentive program for our employees. This is something the county currently does not offer. We have looked at it and looked at age requirements, and we have identified 78 employees that would be eligible for early retirement. The total salary of all those eligible is over $3 million. If we hired those positions back, if all of them said, yes, I want to take the early retirement, we would hire back at the minimum starting level. If we hired them all back, it would be $2,569,000, which is a savings of approximately $500,000. The major savings that come from early retirement is not filling the jobs or look at reorganization within the department. I can't give you a good figure on that because, number one, we don't have a, we don't know who's going to do it, and so I'm just kind of giving you an overall feel of what could happen. We also looked at a buyout based upon what Orange County is currently doing. They have, if we did all 78 employees, the buyout would be $840,000. If we did not fill those positions for a minimum of 90 days, and that's kind of our policy now, is we hold frozen positions for a minimum of 90 days, what that would save us $706,000. So the initial cost to us would be $134,000. So it would be much more if we stretched out the period of when we filled the positions or not. Here's how other counties have used the program. Guilford County does use this program. I've been playing phone tag with their assistant county manager all day trying to get their PowerPoint and their policy. But Onslow County, the county shall pay an employee a lump sum early retirement payment in the gross amount of $10,000 and an incentive of 10 hours for every year of service to the county of Onslow, multiplied by the employee's hourly wage. So there is some incentive for the employee to begin looking at that. And this is how Orange County does their incentive as far as how they calculate how much they're going to pay somebody if they decide to retire early. Any questions on that? Again, we have tried this week to see who may or may not be interested. Very preliminarily, we've had 17 employees show some interest. Number one, it would depend upon what type of plan is approved, how much, you know, but 17 have stated that they may be interested. And looking at those 17, their current salaries are $640,000. The replacement salaries at the lower range, the entry level would be $584,000. And again, we haven't determined if we could eliminate positions or how we would reorganize. So, you know, there is some savings that could be attributed to having an early retirement plan. But at this point, I wouldn't know what it would be or how to budget for it.
Let me ask you a question. In private business, if they buy out people, it's my opinion, they don't replace them, period.
Well,
is this government mindset?
Well, there are certain positions that you would have to fill. Like you would have to fill a department head position.
Well, don't buy them out. I mean, your purpose in private business for buyouts is to eliminate without firing, eliminate without layoffs. Right. And government just comes along and says, oh, we're going to buy them out and turn around and replace them. I mean, it's insanity.
Well, and that's what I'm saying. I think if that's where your cost savings do come from is not filling the positions. But there are some positions that would have to be filled, but you could possibly do some reorganization within the current staffing that you could possibly eliminate some positions within the department through reorganization. But again, not knowing who would be looking at early retirement or not, you know, it's very difficult to say, yeah, we can eliminate the position.
I'm just debating the replacement.
Greg, let me add something. Just say if you have a department of five people and the department head decides to take the early retirement, it opens the door for someone to be promoted, but not at the same level of pay. But that position could be eliminated or not filled at this time, maybe 6 months down the road or when things turn around or somewhere down on that level. Right. So it's going to be probably a reorganization too.
One of the questions that the commissioners asked at the last meeting is, where's our money gone in the 09 budget, 10 budget, and what were, you know, what were the dollar figures? Again, this is based upon our budgetary figures for the 09-10 budget. Sales tax, we're going to be approximately $2 million less. Property tax, again, as we talked, revenue neutral, $1.3 million less. School ADM funds, that's what we talked about earlier, that we're not going to be able to access. So that's $1.7 million we're in the hole. Miscellaneous grants, and you'll see on the next slide that we've lost $2.5 million in miscellaneous grants, but we have cut that expense on the expense side, so that's kind of a wash. EMS revenue right now is down about $500,000. Interest on investments is down $200,000. Miscellaneous revenue is $333,000. Again, a total of $8.5 million as far as the loss of revenue that we have had in this current year's budget. But as you're fully aware, we've tried to adjust for this revenue loss. And what have we done? Again, talked about our insurance cuts, over $1 million, departmental cuts, $1 million, outside agency cuts, $441,000. Again, the lapsed salaries that we've had is $2.4 million. The miscellaneous grants, the offset for that revenue is that expense we don't have. We've also had some miscellaneous savings from all departments of $1.15. So we've tried to really work hard to offset that loss in revenue with the offset in expenses. So that's $8.594 million that we have cut from our expenditures. The question has come up about fund balance and where do we project our fund balance to be at year end. The goal that we had originally, I think, goes back to February when we first started talking about these cuts, and after we got the audit report, was let's see what we could do to not use any fund balance this year, or at least minimize the amount of fund balance we were going to use. We were going to be close if we'd have gotten the ATM funds. But as you can see, we budgeted to use $2.96 million in fund balance. Actual as of April 30th, we've used 2.5, and estimated through year end is $2.9 million. Less than we budgeted for, but we're still going to use it. So we're hopefully, you know, again, we still got 2 months revenues. Hopefully sales tax are picking up a little bit. Hopefully it will not be as bad, but this is looking at our best figures and projections as of today. Fund balance balances. Again, as we talked about, major use of fund balance this year is the ADM funds. You know, we would have been in fair shape if we could have gotten ADM funds. Undesignated fund balance as of July 1, 2009, $10.931 million. Estimated undesignated fund balance on July 1, 2010, little over $8 million. Undesignated fund balance will be 6.5% with a total fund balance of 11%, and that includes appropriated funds as well. And again, the state mandates that we have an 8% minimum. The big bear in the woods, it was supposed to growl.
It's growling. But
the big bear in the woods, even if we are okay and to survive this year, next year is going to be the bear. The state will lose over $2 billion in the American Recovery and Reinvestment Act funding that has supplemented the last two state budgets. So this will be the 10-11 budget will be the last year that states will supplement their budgets. We don't know what else will be cut back from the state or how they will shift service responsibilities from the state to the county. So that, again, is a big unknown. Again, next year, a healthy fund balance may be as important as ever. So I wanted y'all to be aware and make sure that we're aware of what could come up next year. And again, in talking with Dr. Bridges, the schools are even more nervous next year than they are this year. He has actually called it a tsunami of cuts that he could possibly see, as far as, you know, when we looked at last year's budget, they really didn't have to cut teachers. They did not have to cut really any direct services. I think internally they saw some things, but further cuts are going to require cuts to teachers and cuts to positions and larger class sizes and on and on and on. So next year is going to be really, again, the big bear in the woods. The big question of this budget, and this is where we need your guidance so we can move forward to get you a recommended budget. At this point, with cuts recommended to this point, we're projected to use in next year's fund balance, or next year's budget, $2 million in fund balance. It's about $1.6 million more than we originally looked at because of the ADM funds. We're looking about $400,000, I think I told you 2 weeks ago, but with some change, we're about $2 million in the hole. Again, a tax increase of 1.75 cents will bring in a little over $2 million. And I think we've got four options to consider. And this is where I need your direction on. We can look at further cuts. We can go back to the departments and say we've got to find more cuts. Some departments, we would have to start looking at personnel. We are cut very tight in a lot of departments, you know, that we may have to start looking at personnel. We could look at a tax increase or some type of increase, a tax increase. It doesn't have to be that. That's just a suggestion. We can use $2 million from fund balance. Hope that sales tax will increase, that Tanger will come through, that things will pick up, the economy will get better. Or we can do a combination of all three, or two. What's next? If we can get a consensus on how you want us to find that $2 million, we can get you a draft manager's recommended budget at our next meeting. And then at that point, we would set the public hearing for June 7th.
Have you included the furloughs that we talked about? Is that included?
Yes, ma'am. That already includes all the cuts.
Already included.
That's
all the cuts that we talked about 2 weeks ago are included in the budget. And even with that, we still come up with a $2 million shortfall.
Okay. Well, I hear some comments from the board.
In my opinion, if the people that I've talked to that loses their jobs or gets their salaries cut, they cut things that they have that they can afford to give up first, and the next things they cut essentials after that. And I think it's just wrong to ask the taxpayers to fund, especially in a recession, to raise their taxes. I'm just not in favor of raising taxes.
So do you have a suggestion for an alternative on that?
Yeah. You got to cut whatever you have to do.
Where do we cut? No,
that's up to the manager.
Do we need, what about the use of fund balance?
I wouldn't be in favor of that.
I hope we don't use your fund balance.
Bill, would you be in favor, more in favor? I don't think we have some really good options here of that quarter cent tax as a referendum.
I'm not in favor of any kind of tax.
Well,
here's the problem with government. When times are good, they spend money like drunken sailors, and when they go into a recession, they turn around and ask the people to fund up more of their money. Government has got to learn to do like everybody else, and that is within their means. And in good times, you don't spend everything.
Let me ask you a question.
I've seen it time and time again. It's just the same recessions, the same situations happen.
Lottery money. Do we have to have their permission to pay our debt service for schools from the lottery money?
We can't touch their lottery money.
That's the holy cow right there.
That's the holy grail.
Sacred cow.
Yeah. I mean, they have to have our approval for what they spend out of it, don't they?
No, sir.
I mean, how do they go? They can go build classrooms with it and don't have to have our approval?
Yes, sir. They can't buy property. But they can renovate, they can add on, they can do all they want to with the lottery money.
Why do we vote on it then? Sir? We vote on it.
Well, what we voted on for the Career Tech Center was that we agreed that instead of them coming back to us and asking us for that debt service, that they would have to come up with that debt service themselves using the lottery money. So that was kind of their agreement saying, yeah, we're going to make sure that we fund that out of our pot of money, not using county dollars or additional county dollars other than the $130,000 that we got on the savings from the bond refinancing.
So when they build classrooms at one of the schools with lottery money, they don't have to have our approval?
No, sir.
But we've given it before. I mean, we voted on it before. I'm positive.
Yeah, we voted on it just about every time. If we don't have a say, well, they shouldn't even bring it before us.
And other counties are using lottery proceeds to finance the debt. I don't know if the school systems are agreeing on it or not.
Right. I'm sure they are, Mr. Sutton, probably. And the reason some of those things come to the board is because when they use the lottery money, it has to actually come through the county, so we have to put it into the budget so they can use it. So that's why y'all see some of the budget amendments. But there are some counties that uses lottery funds for debt service, but the school system would have to approve that because they have pretty much complete control over those lottery funds.
I tried to get this emailed in here today to where all the other commissioners could have it, and they sent the wrong address to Pat. They put a hyphen in, a hyphen instead of a dot. That's why we didn't get it to you. And Craig, I emailed Craig a copy of it that I had gotten. But the County Commissioners Association has a 2009-2010 report on county employees per population unit. And you've already talked to me tonight about it. You were looking at the total average for the state, which I think is sort of like looking at per pupil funding expenditures for the schools by looking at the total state, which is kind of not apples to oranges. But here, which I think is more closer to the fruit, apples to apples, might be green versus red apples, but it's still an apple in my opinion. There's 11 counties that have more population than us, but basically the same as us, but it's over us, not under us. Might be one or two, one out of the 11 here. I've done this tonight really quickly. But there's 11 counties that have same population, basically, give or take 1,000 or two. But majority of those 11 are definitely bigger than us. And of those 11, 7 have a lower number of employees. Not by just one or two employees. Now, you can get into the debate as to how many of those counties have what amount of population in municipalities versus us. So, yes, there's all kind of variables you can throw in here. But just for the sake of, Cabarrus County has got 30,000 more than us, almost 25,000, yet they've got 77 less employees, 77. Davidson County's got roughly 13,000 more population, but 23 less employees. Iredale's got 9,000 to 10,000 more in population, 66 less employees. Onslow, well, I don't want to give Onslow because of the military base. Orange County, God's gift to fiscal responsibility, has about 15,000 less than us, but population, but 98 less employees, according to County Commissioner Association chart here that I'm looking at. Pitt County has got 10,000 more in population, 46 less employees. Randolph has 5,000 less population, 272 less employees. We need to ride down there and just see what the flat heck they're doing. Even if we don't want to match it, they're doing something right. And the last one, Rowan, 7,000 less less population total, 98 less employees. I think it shows a pattern, in my opinion, that we're overstaffed at the county level. Now, that's tough for me to say. And I know I'm not going to get any votes from county employees. That's not why I'm here. I don't know what the answer is for this, but I think overstaffing is part of the problem that we could look at.
Part of that, Kim, you know, was in DSS that some of the counties don't even have the food stamp program.
Randolph's one of them.
Yeah. And I don't know what they – I mean, I think we need to look at that in a different way and say, well, do they have a EMS?
They don't have
EMS. They don't have a recreation.
I admit that. But the County Commissioner Association can't be more authoritative as far as somebody you can rely on as far as the statistic goes.
Well,
I admit it's not
– Craig and I just went to that district meeting, and very informative.
Yeah.
But I think, too, that you can't just say – this is what it is, because I think you need to...
I just reported stats from the County Commissioner Association.
I understand, but they didn't break it down as to what departments were not funded or what departments they didn't have. So I think we need to look at the big picture there, too.
A county is a county.
I understand that, too.
And I do believe that some other counties are whipping our fannies with efficiency that are our size versus... And I think the same is with the school system. You know, they want more money. I have a problem with letting them take that ADM money, and again, you say they can do it, buying technology. You walk into computer labs over there now, and they're sitting at the computer labs are empty. A lot of them, the ones I go in, and the ones I go in, the ones that are sitting there, a handful, playing games on them. I'm going to call it like it is, and people get mad all they want. But we got a hell of a mess from top to bottom, Washington to Graham.
Do I hear any more comments? We got to get Mr. Hancock somewhere to go. Well, the thing that I look at too, we lowered our revenue neutral too much. I mean, we know we did that, you know, and this wouldn't even put it back to revenue neutral, would it?
The 175, I believe, will be get us right at revenue neutral, or
it's about what the two and a quarter
was revenue. I'm sorry, and a quarter.
Okay, so this wouldn't even get us back to revenue neutral, which we went too low on. So I mean, and I hate to increase people to taxes too, because I'm a taxpayer myself, which they just increased my taxes for putting a carport on. Yeah, I mean, I'd be willing to debate for a tax increase, but I mean, I understand other people don't want that, or like Ann says, other tax, the 0.75, is that what it was?
Quarter cent
sales.
Quarter cent
referendum.
Sales.
Yeah, the referendum.
Right. Let the people decide.
I'm not saying it's bad, I'm just saying.
Mm-hmm. I mean, we got to get this money from somewhere. Which we keep using our fund balance, we're going to really be in trouble with the state. So that's my opinion.
At least the quarter cent would generate, what, $2 million? Is that
2.2,
right?
I believe.
2.4.
But that's
Property tax owners can decide if they want to keep carrying the load or do we want to share it in sales tax.
That's right.
Well, if we did that on a sales tax, and I agree with Bill, I don't like taxes. I don't think we should have any more taxes. But, hey, we got to do something. Reality strikes here. It hits everybody. It hits, and we can't keep hitting the property owners anyway. This hits everybody that shops in Alamance
spreads.
County.
Yes,
yeah, spreads it out, or shops, comes here to shop. But
and
I'm just tossing it out, and I'm saying what I think.
If the board did decide to put it on as a referendum and it did pass, again, it would not be revenue we could budget this year. It would probably be something that would be part of our fund balance, that it would be just additional revenue that we would look at budget.
But if we did use the fund balance this year and we could
as a loan
to supplement next year.
To bridge it over.
Right.
Yeah. Right. But that's an option as well.
But if you did do that, I wouldn't want... If you decide to do it as a referendum, and if the people voted for it, if it passed, I wouldn't want it to stay on there any longer than is necessary. in other words, just get us over the hump of what we're doing, and when times get better, and they will, take that quarter cent back off. Does not make it permanent, in other words.
Temporary taxes always become permanent.
That's why I'm stipulating that, Bill.
I'm not sure.
I don't know that once you enact.
I'm not sure if there's a sunset on that.
We could repeal it, I guess.
I guess you can, but I've not heard of any talk about somebody doing that. So, I guess let me take a wild stab at this right now.
You're going to be a mind reader tonight.
I'm going to try to be a mind reader a little bit. We're saying, as a board, we do not want to look at a tax increase, or the majority, or consensus, we do not want to look at a tax increase. Are we saying maybe to look at cuts and maybe to use part of the fund balance as well, hope that things will turn around, maybe not use it to the $2 million level that we are talking about, use a combination?
I think we need a plan B.
What percentage? You know, you and I had talked earlier about we were 1.4% away from balancing the budget, right, with no tax increase. Right. Is that figure still the same?
Yes. If we're $2 million in short, and it's a, what's the total budget, Amy? I'm sorry.
The total budget.
134.
What's $1 million? $10 million.
Yeah.
So we're within 1.4?
Yeah.
Okay. You don't raise taxes in this type of economy when you're only 1.4% away. You find the cuts. You make it more efficient. Not saying you haven't done a good job. You have. You're in one heck of a...
He has done a tremendous job on his numbers, I'm going to tell you.
You're that close, 1.4%, and then you sit back, oh, man, if it was 25%, I could see some of the logic here. But to say we're 1.4% away in a $134 million budget, but we can't make it without raising taxes, to me, that's just weak. A mentality for us to have. I'll put it on us. No, I'm not voting for tax increase. Ain't no way.
What about if we looked at a combination of cuts and fund balance?
I think that's the direction we got.
It's the only options you got.
If you're not going to raise taxes, then that is the option.
We got to evaluate our personnel. I mean, we got to come to some conclusion that we think we either not overstaffed, that we're staffed okay. I say we're overstaffed as a total. Now,
and we can do that, and that can be if that's a directive from the board, we can go back and work with our departments and look at staffing levels and do some comparisons, you know, between us and those similar type county, so that we are comparing apples to apples on that. But if we could do that, it would probably mean more for us moving forward. But to get us through July 1, are you saying cuts and fund balance? Is that a consensus to move forward?
Yeah.
I don't have a problem with that.
I don't have a problem with that.
$2 million.
And that leaves us with... You told me the fund balance total, designated and undesignated, right, including the 8%, was $22 million, right? Is that still correct?
It may be a little more than that. The total fund balance, I think, is 24.
Yeah.
My goodness, so we just find millions in everywhere.
but a lot of that is set aside in reserve. The undesignated fund balance that we have to use to balance the budget is the 10.9.
Oh, yeah.
And if we use part of that this year because the school system won't give up their ADM funds, then
I'll go to the 8.
How much do we give them on their tech center, for their tech center?
We are giving them $130,000 a year for 12 years.
That was the debt service.
This is for debt service.
Didn't we agree to something else that they had to have our agreement on?
The resolution we agree was that we would put the $130,000 in, but they had to use their lottery proceeds for their part of the debt service, so that they're not going to have to come back to us, and we have to carry that debt. So that they will pay, I think it's about a $500,000 payment a year. They're going to pay about $400,000 from the lottery.
Did they have to have our approval for the stimulus?
No, sir.
I'm just...
Well, the stimulus is just kind of the stopgap, really funding from the state. Yeah. It's funding from the state.
I'm just disturbed that they don't want to play ball except to the limited degree they want to play it. And we're supposed to be a family here, and I just don't see it. They'll want our vote for something else or my vote for something else in the future, and we'll see how it plays out.
Okay. I'll say that also.
Do you have your director now?
I believe I do. We will present you a balanced budget with no tax increase at our 2 weeks from today.
Okay. Does it matter where we cut?
That's up to y'all.
Does it have to be in our departments?
So, yeah. Okay. All right.
What do you recommend?
She don't have a recommendation.
I recommend the school system. They kind of got us in this situation, so that's where I would take it.
That is an option.
They added 4.1 to their funding.
Thank you for waking me up on that. Their per pupil funding level is X amount of dollars, right?
Yes,
X
sir.
Amount of dollars. We could roll that back $100 a student.
Let's do it.
Yes, sir. Let's play ball. I'm willing to play hard ball.
I'll make that motion that we cut it back on.
Well, whatever. Let's play hard ball.
I can't do that yet.
Well, I'm just saying, let's think about it.
We need to leave it up to them and let them come back to us with the option.
We're not obligated.
And then we have other issues that we can go, Craig, as of. I know, if not right away, but early retirement, some other things that we could possibly do.
Right. If the board is agreeable on the early retirement issue, let us get through the budget part first, and then we will come back and address the early retirement issue with a policy and procedures and give you more accurate numbers on where we can go from there.
There was a column in the paper from Ms. Gant.
I happen to see that.
On Sunday, had the audacity to say that our taxes are so low that we should raise our taxes so that we can be more progressive. And the mindset there is just stunning. But right here is a chart from Public School Forum that shows the per pupil funding level of every system in the state. And if you look at the systems that are financed, they have roughly the same number of students we have, give or take 2,000 or 3,000. We're right where we should be. Matter of fact, the public school foreman is no John Locke think tank, I'll assure you. Can't be more progressive and liberal towards school funding, and that's not saying that negatively. But they say that our ability, based on their analysis of our county, evaluations, debt, everything, our ability is 45th. In the state to finance schools, and their actual effort is 45th. And we're not obligated to give according to this chart here, and I'll be quiet, but this chart shows here that our per pupil funding level, and you get all kind of different figures here, but 22, I think it's the way you analyze it, but like $1,200 per pupil or something like that. We're not obligated to give them $1,200 a student. We can drop that to $1,100. And that would save $2 million right there.
I'll make that motion.
Well, let's let them figure it out.
If the board is direct to me, we will put an option on there to reduce the school funding as well.
Now, I do support that.
Okay. We will list that as an option for you to consider.
Come back and let us know.
And when we balance the budget, that will be one of the options.
Okay.
All right. Thank y'all.
Now, if they want to try and give us ADM money, we might not have to do that.
Okay. Next is our consent agenda. Does anybody want to put anything on the consent agenda?
No.
I make a motion to accept the consent agenda.
Second.
Okay, have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Next thing is a closed session. I move that we now go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute Section 143-318.11A3 in order to preserve the attorney-client privilege between the county attorney and the Board of Commissioners. Need a motion?
I'll make a motion. We go into closed session.
Second.
Yes.
If I may, is this for an existing lawsuit?
It just says attorney. We're just going into closed session. That's all I say.
This way, you have it all be done.
I have a motion on the floor. I need a second.
You got a second?
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. That's good.